In this tutorial, we see the fastest and most efficient way to match records in Excel, and return their corresponding and relevant values. There are many examples where this function is useful. In this video, we will see a simple case, yet somehow practical, that involves index matching to look up the values. The concept, however, is general and applies to any other scenario that involves matching. Before we start, let us have a quick look at an example where this function is applicable. You have a sheet that contains the grades for students. For simplicity, we assume a small number of students as well as only two subjects. We want to consolidate the two grades into one table. We can use the index match function to quickly perform this task. The solution is illustrated at the end of the tutorial. In all the following illustrated examples, we use one sheet to make it easier to understand. The data, however, can be placed on multiple different sheets or workbooks. The index match function is important when matching datasets originating from different sources but share a certain key identifier such as an ID or name. As the availability of a unique identifier is critical to the index match function, you have to think about the available possibilities when such identifier is not available. For example, if your table doesn't contain a unique identifier, such as an ID but contains the first and second name of a person, you can concatenate the two names to have a unique identifier, given that some first names and/or last names might be identical. Upon doing so, you have to check that all new identifiers are unique. This can be accomplished through various means as we will explain later. To concatenate or join two cells, you use the IN symbol. We use column C for concatenation, and place the formula. If you desire space between the two names, you use two double quotations separated by space. To this end, you can concatenate the values directly in the match function, but I would advise to do it in a separate column as we just did for speeding up the process, especially if you are working with large data sets. Back to the index match function, there are many cases where it is very helpful. It is useful in academic research where, for example, different data sets contain diverse information related to stocks but all use the same stock code. It is also useful in companies when you need to consolidate sales or purchases originating from different sources. Another example would be an academic institution where a person is required to consolidate all grades of different subjects. The last case is illustrated in this tutorial. To move forward, let us understand how the match and index functions work on their own. The match function requires an identifier to match one value to another within a defined range. It returns the row number of the match. For example, if we want to see if there's a cell in a column that matches an individual cell, we use the match function. Let us see an example. We want to see if there are matches in column E for the IDs in column A. We use column B to look up such match. We start by entering the equal sign and then type match. We open brackets. The match function has three inputs, the lookup value which is A2 inches our example. Lookup array or range which is E2 to E20, and match type which is 0 inches our case as we are looking for exact matches. I've used the match function numerous times and the match type I used was always 0, but there might be cases where you need the other two. Depending on what you are looking for, you mostly need to lock the used range by using the dollar sign, because otherwise it will change if we copy the formula to a different cell. The keyboard shortcut is the F4 button. As you can notice, the output of the formula is 4, which corresponds to E5 because our defined range starts at E2 and not at E1. If we change the range to E1, the output becomes 5, which corresponds to the same cell, E5. Practically speaking, it doesn't really matter if we define the range start as E1 or E2 as long as we remember what we used. Additionally, for the index match function, it doesn't matter if we use any of the two as long as there is a consistency in the definition. Now, we copy the formula downward. The matched row for the second cell content, A3, is 9. Note that if we change the content in A2 to a value that is not included in the defined lookup range, the function returns an error, which means that no match was found. Additionally, if the value we are looking for is repeated within a range, the match function returns the topmost value. If you are afraid that there might be duplicates in your dataset resulting from an error, you might want to use one of the functions that count the number of unique records, such as the COUNTIF or some product functions. I would recommend to avoid using the Remove Duplicates tool if you are not sure whether there is an error with your data, because if there is an error, you won't be able to track it this way. You may also use Pivot Tables, a very powerful Excel tool that returns only unique records from a defined range. It is very fast and efficient when working with large data. Now, we need to understand how the index function works before we use the combination of both. We have a table consisting of the grades for students. The index function, as the name indicates, indexes a table and returns any value within this table. The function has three inputs. The range, which would be the table in our case, F3 to I8. We lock it by using the dollar sign. The second input is the row number and the last is the column number. For example, if we use 1 as the row number and 1 as the column number, the return value would be Chris because we looked up the cell at the first column and first row in the defined table. If we change the row number to 5, the return value becomes Mark, and so on. You can change the values in the source file located under the description of this tutorial and see the resulting effects. One important note before we move further is that the index function can return more than one cell in a row if we define the column number as 0. To do so, we copy the formula to the adjacent cells depending on how many we need. Then, we need to use an array formula since more than one value is required. We just select the cells, point to the formula bar, and hit the Control, Shift, and Enter buttons at the same time. This is how you use and apply an array formula in Excel. If you change the row number to 1, we will retrieve the grades for Chris. The row number can't exceed the number of rows in the index table, which is 6 inches this example. If we use 7, the formula will return an error. The same applies to the number of columns. Note that if we define the row number as 0 and use an array formula, the first return value will be the first column in the index table. Now, we will see how to use the combination of the two functions. We will consider two cases. In the first one, we just need to look up the grades for mathematics for selected students. While in the second, we look up the total grade of each subject to obtain the overall running grade. We start with case 1. The left table includes some IDs that we need to look up their related information. To make it easier to understand, we will first use the index function, and then append the match function into it. First, let us look up students' names. We use the index function, define the table range as G2 to K34, and the column number corresponding to student's name. It is 2, the second column of the table in this case. Let us use any row number for now. Note that if we were only looking for the name, the table range would be only the first two column, but we will index the whole table in our example. As the match function returns the row number, the trick is to replace the random row number we placed with the match function. We do so by typing match and opening brackets. The match criteria would be the ID at A2. The lookup range would be just the ID column in the lookup table because the match function can handle only one-dimensional array. We lock it using the dollar sign, and we indicate the match type as exact by entering 0 to get the required result. If we are looking only for the student name and total, we copy the same formula we just made from the formula bar and paste it under total in E2. We just change the column number in this formula to 5 to get the total. If we want to get all the corresponding values, we either repeat the last mentioned step in each column or use an array formula as explained before after changing the column number to 0. As the array formula returns all the columns within a table starting from the most left, which is the ID column in our case, We need to add an additional column for the repeated ID. We can, however, delete this column directly after we finish matching. To get all the values, we copy the formula by copying the cell into the adjacent cells, get focus into the formula bar, hold the Ctrl and Shift buttons, and hit Enter. Now, we have all the corresponding values. We drag the formulas downwards and we are done. As the newly created column doesn't have any added value, we can delete it, but since we can change part of an array, we first need to copy the return data and paste it as values and then delete. Now, we move into the second case where we need to look up the total grade for all students. We have the grades for two classes, mathematics and physics. Both classes include the same students. As you can notice, however, not all students sat for the physics exam. Additionally, one student sat for the physics exam but not math. Thus, as a first step, we need to make a list of all available students. One easy way is to create an additional sheet and copy the IDs, which are unique, and students' names of each class into the same column. Since we know there are no errors in our data, to remove duplicates, we use the built-in Excel tool, Remove Duplicates. We select the range and apply. Now, we have the required list of unique students. We just sorted by student name. Although sorting is not necessary, it retains consistency. Then, we copy it into the main sheet and delete the new sheet we just created. In this example, we don't need an array formula since we are looking at one value in each table. First, we use the index function as before. For math grade, we index the mathematics as table. Now, we insert the match function in place of the row number. We define the lookup criteria to be the ID as before, and define the lookup range or array as the ID column in the math table. The match type would be 0 as before. We use 5 as the column number since we are looking at the total grade. We copy the formula downward to cover all students. As you can notice, the formula returns error when the students didn't sit for the exam as in the case of Vitelli. To overcome this problem, we can either replace it with a value or use an if error statement like I do. The if error statement returns a defined content that could be number or text string in case the used formula returns an error. Thus, it has two inputs, the formula and the value to return in case there is an error. We add a fur and open brackets. At the end of the formula, we add comma and insert the contents we want to display. Although the unavailability of a grade doesn't mean zero, I will determine the error to return 0 in just case there is no grade so we can sum the two grades to get the running total later on. If we were to use a text string such as NA for not applicable, we just have to surround the content with quotes since it is a text string. We apply the same for the physics grade. To save time, I will just copy the formula source and paste it to the adjacent column. We just need to change the ranges. Everything else remains the same. We copy the formula downwards. Then, we just add the two values under the total and we are done. That was all regarding the index match function. I hope it was useful.